Hi, my name is Timothy Caselitz.
And I'm Lauren Ward.
And we're going to be doing a point-of-care ultrasound technique demonstrating left ventricular outflow tract velocity time integral along with a passive leg raise.
Focused cardiac ultrasound, or FOCUS, is performed at the bedside and provides a limited number of standard echocardiographic views to evaluate heart structures and cardiac contractility, and to assess intravascular volume. FOCUS is performed in patients with sepsis and septic shock and can predict volume responsiveness, the hemodynamic response to volume expansion with an intravenous fluid bolus. One method to induce a reversible increase in preload is the passive leg raise, which transfers about 300 milliliters of venous blood from the legs to the right side of the heart.
So it's important for the patient to be in a relatively flat position, in a recumbent position. Right now, we have our patient 10 degrees head up just for comfort, which is also totally fine. And Lauren's going to start by getting an apical four chamber of the heart. She does that by feeling for the PMI, and that tells her where to put the probe. Important for the indicator marker to be pointed towards the patient's left or our right. Lauren, why don't you walk us through what you're doing to optimize it?
So I'm kind of making small adjustments, sort of minor rocking back and forth. To one, I want to get my septum in the middle as vertical as possible, and then also to get all four chambers into view to start.
So Lauren has a pretty textbook four-chamber view there. Lauren, why don't you talk us through how you're going to bring in the fifth chamber?
So I'm going to make a very slight rotation of my probe clockwise, and then I can get a nice opening of that fifth chamber. They already fell there.
Great. And so there's a textbook apical five-chamber view there. The fifth chamber, just for folks that aren't familiar, refers to the LV outflow tract, recognizing that's not an actual chamber of the heart, but by convention, that's what it's called. So yeah, so what Lauren did there was she dropped the tail of the probe down, tipping the probe more anteriorly, bringing in the aortic valve and the LV outflow tract. So now, Lauren, tell us what you're going to do.
So now I'm going to do my pulse wave Doppler, and I'm going to get my gate just proximal to the aortic valve.
Notice that she's aligning the Doppler angle with the angle of blood flow. And move that baseline up. So what Lauren has there, she has a nice tracing of pulse wave Doppler signal. What it represents on the y-axis is the speed of blood flow. Right at that gate, right in between those two bars, that is the speed of blood flow going through the LVOT. And then on the x-axis is time. So again, the y-axis is velocity of the blood flow at the point of that Doppler gate, and the x-axis is time.
So the next step, I'm going to open up my calculators to trace the outline of my LVOT. So I can get calculators here. I go to my cardiac output and my LVOT VTI. And I'm going to pick one of these triangular shaped.
So she's being very careful to trace it accurately. Modern machines can do this automatically. Some machines have some other tools that make it a little bit easier on the user. What we have there is the LVOT VTI, which stands for velocity time integral. And what you're doing is you're integrating velocity over time, and that gives you an area under the curve. And in this case, it's 24.1. So we've repositioned our patient. He's approximately 30 degrees legs up. It's really important that you do some sort of passive process to do this rather than actively lifting the legs, as that can cause pain to the patient and it can skew the results. So now Lauren's going to repeat the process. Again, getting that apical five chamber view. It's a nice signal there. She's going to do the same process again. Again, getting that LVOT VTI, which is again a surrogate measurement for stroke volume. And what this will effectively tell Lauren is whether or not giving volume to the patient will augment their stroke volume.
25.6. And our last one was 24.
And so a change of about 10 to 15% are typically the cutoffs in the literature for deciding that somebody is indeed volume responsive. In other words, if the stroke volume increases by 10 to 15%, then that would suggest that this patient is fluid responsive. And if the clinical situation would be appropriate, one could consider giving a fluid bolus. In this case, our patient did not meet that threshold. So again, depending on the clinical circumstances, would be evidence to withhold fluid and think about other ways to manage hypotension or shock.